I see 7 o'clock up there.
I do too.
So, all right. With that, I am going to call the meeting to order. This is the regular council meeting for the City of Minnetrista for August 15th. I'd like to first ask that you all join me for Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And just a reminder, if you have electronic devices with you, please turn them on silent or turn them off so we don't interrupt our proceedings. So with that, I'd first like to start with making some introductions. I'm Lisa Whalen, I'm the mayor. And to my left are council members Patricia Thole, Mark Vanderlinde, Pam Mortensen, and Bob Christians. And on the end, we have our city engineer, Paul Hornby with WSB, and our city clerk, Chris Lindquist. And to my right, I have our city administrator, Mike Baroni, finance director, Brian Grimm, our planner, assistant planner, Nick Olson, our city attorney with Kennedy and Graven, Ron Beatty, and on the end, we have our chief of police, Paul Falls. So with that, I'd like to, we have approval of our agenda. Are there any changes to the agenda? Or any additions?
Mayor, I would like to have the council approve the agenda without item 4K, which is the MOU, Memorandum of Understanding with Local 49. I did get an inquiry today from the business agent, and he said they had a few questions, and last week they said they didn't, so today they do, so I'd much rather take it off and bring it back than try to pass it twice.
So we'll remove that from the agenda completely. All right. Any other additions or subtractions? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the agenda as presented with that subtraction, 4K?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Seconded.
Okay. Mr. Christian seconded that. All right. All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed, motion passes. Next, we'll move on to our special presentations, and we have two this evening. We're going to start out with Tiffany Schaufler with the Minnehaha Creek Watershed District, and she's going to give us a presentation on the Jennings Bay Wetland Floodplain, and I think it's floodplain rather than wetland, isn't it?
Restoration, both.
All right, both.
A little bit of both.
Thank you. All right, go ahead, please, and Ms. welcome.
Yeah, Ms. Mayor, council members, thank you for having me tonight. As Ms. Mayor introduce, I'm Tiffany Schaufler. I work for the Minnehaha Creek Watershed District. I'm a project and land manager for the Watershed District and going on my sixth year with the district in total. So tonight we're going to review the design for this project, which is a joint project with the city and the district are taking on. We held a public meeting last Monday to receive public comments, and we've coordinated also the design to this point with the city engineer and city staff. So I'm just going to run through project components, talk about the design specifics of that itself, and then end with the cost estimate, benefits, and schedule. And then if there's any questions, I can take those. So this project, from the district's point of view, it's a bit of a weird project because it involves two pieces of land and two different projects. So the Watershed District is doing what we're calling the Highway 101 Causeway Reconstruction Project, which is shown in the circle on the right. So currently, Hennepin County has come through the city of Wayzata and Minnetonka. They've widened the County Road 101, what we refer to as the Causeway. After that project is done, which is in the next couple of months, the Wayzata Bay side of the Causeway is left with just a sheet pile in the water, so there's no existing shoreline. So that's where the Watershed District's coming into place. We're coming in and reconstructing that shoreline. But by doing that, we're technically filling part of Lake Minnetonka's 100-year floodplain. So when we were looking at how we should mitigate for this, we began discussion with the city of Minnetrista, and through that also realized the city, during the 2014 flooding, needed some floodplain mitigation as part of the Enchanted Lane, filling of that to raise the road at that time. So in October of 2014, the Watershed District and the city entered into a cooperative agreement which said that we would jointly look at seeing if this project site would be a viable area to do that mitigation from the city's perspective and for the watersheds, and work on actually transferring that parcel of land to the watershed district. So we investigated it, and it showed that there was enough room for both the watershed district's project and the city's project. So we have moved forward with design. So just to help provide some context, so the city's parcel is currently outlined in red. You have the Orchard Cove development immediately to the west, and then Painter Creek comes into the north and runs along the parcel, and then outlets into Jennings Bay in the southeast. So the watershed district currently needs 650 cubic yards for the County Road 101 mitigation, and the city needs 500 cubic yards for the Enchanted Lane. So that puts us at about 1150 cubic yards total. We've done, what we've said is let's do 1250 just to provide a little bit of buffer in case one project goes one way or the other. So essentially the goal of this project is to create floodplain storage and from the watershed district perspective also enhance the vegetation across the parcel. So now we'll get into some of the project details. This is just an overall site plan. It shows the grading area. So most of the grading is happening on the northern part of the parcel. And the purpose of this is to stay away from an existing wetland that's on the south part of the parcel and also a high point that you see just to the south of this, which means we'd have to do more excavation to get down to that the floodplain level on Lake Minnetonka. We're focusing on this area also because it currently drains to the northwest to an existing pipe, which I'm going to use in my next picture. No.
Oops, one more.
This is generally what the area looks like when you're standing. Sorry, this is just delayed a little bit. There's the existing pipe. So that's what the existing currently the land drains to that northwest and exits out of this pipe. We're proposing to remove this pipe, replace it with a concrete pipe at that same elevation, but then would allow the water to enter the floodplain mitigation at that 929.4 mark, which is where the floodplain starts on Lake Minnetonka. So that's generally what we'll do is come in, we'll grade a bunch of material out, and then we plan to revegetate. So our plan proposes to remove around 40 trees to be able to do that grading, but we plan to plant at least 350 trees and shrubs across the site. Currently across the site, there's a lot of box elder trees that are down and not really providing much screening. What we've heard from the residents is screening is very important to screen the housing developments both ways. So we looked at a variety of species that will provide different heights of screening for those residents on both sides. We also are proposing along the shoreline, which is kind of that teal color, to plant live stakes. We've heard a lot from the residents as well that is eroding into Lake Minnetonka. So we are proposing to plant their own 700 live stakes, which are taking willows or dogwood species and putting them into the bank so they'll regrow and spread. And this is just showing the access to the site, so we're proposing to access off of County Road 110 using the city's existing road where they have a lift station and then accessing through Orchard Cove's outlot, which the city has an easement over. So here we have the estimated cost. We're currently sitting right around where we thought we were going to be. We were estimating $175,000 when we initially looked at the project. So we're looking at around $172,000 currently. And with that, the city's share is still estimated to be around $25,000. So when we entered into that cooperative agreement, the city agreed that they would cover their costs of their mitigation piece. So that's where we're at. That I'm not quite sure all that exactly will shake out, but that's our preliminary estimates. And then benefits, obviously, are floodplain storage. So as I said, we're going to meet at least what we need from the cities and watershed districts perspective, but also trying to go a little bit above that to create some additional storage where we can, providing habitat enhancement. Currently, as I said, a lot of the understory is kind of a monoculture of box elder trees, so trying to get some more diversity with trees and shrubs in there to add some extra habitat value in the area. And then a big thing is also stabilizing that existing shoreline, so stopping erosion from happening along that bank and just stabilizing that with some also additional good understory species. So our schedule, we plan to review the final design with the MCW board at their August 25th meeting. We will then Assuming we get approvals to go out for bid, solicit bids, end of August into mid-September, and then we would award the construction contract at our September 22nd board meeting. Then from there, it's anticipated we'll do construction in October or November of this year, and then likely do the plantings next spring. And then with all of our contracts, we always include at least a 3-year vegetation warranty and maintenance to make sure that the vegetation is actually established and the tree survived and that it's meeting the performance standards that we expected of the project. And with that, I can take any questions.
Does the council have any questions? Otherwise, I just have a couple, maybe more for staff, but with the city share, will that be covered by FEMA, or do we just have to roll that into maybe the Enchanted Lane project?
They put you on the spot here, you know, or otherwise we'll get back.
I do not have the answer for that question,
okay.
Unfortunately.
All right. We should check and see if it possibly, because it's a floodplain mitigation, because we had to restore that road, that it might be a FEMA project. I don't know if you can find out.
Sure. Paul, have you any idea about the answer to the mayor's question? Would this 25K be something that we'd be able to submit to FEMA?
Well, what FEMA did is FEMA actually reimbursed the city for cost to restore the Enchanted Lane. There is a process we can go through for improvement, and that's actually through the state.
Okay.
So we can apply for some of that to
okay.
see if we can get any reimbursement out of that.
And I think we should. I mean, okay, great.
And we can do that, though, after our project is complete, and we might be past the timeline to do that, but I'll check those dates with FEMA.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Anybody else have any questions? Okay. Thank you very much. All right. With that, then we'll move on to our second presentation for the evening, and this is regarding our dog bite ordinance discussion. We're going to start with our chief of police. He's going to give us kind of an overview. This was, I asked staff to put this on our agenda for this evening based on some emails that you have all probably seen, and based on a recent situation with a resident's dog, and so I said I would put it on here so that the chief could inform the council as to what's going on and what the different issues are. And then I also promised the individual that I would read a letter that she had submitted to us, and then that will be read into the record. And then if there's, of course, any questions that the council has, you can ask that of Mr. Falls, and we'll move on from there. So, Chief.
Very good. Thank you, Madam Mayor, Council. As the mayor stated, my intention here with my presentation is I guess I'll back up. We do get a number of questions from time to time regarding dangerous or potentially dangerous dogs, or otherwise known as dog bites. And we get a fair amount of those in our city each year. And I understand that it can and has been kind of an emotional topic for many people. And I understand that as a dog owner myself. So. Certainly, we look at all these cases individually and do what we can, and we're very empathetic with dog owners while still doing all we can to ensure the safety of the victim. So with that, my intention here is to kind of give you a high-level overview of a dog bite case, or basically the process that we used, and kind of walk you through that. Certainly, at any point while I'm going through this, if you have questions, feel free to interrupt me at any time, and I'll be happy to answer those if I can. So with that, I guess I'll go ahead and get started. Brian, I guess I'll just ask you to go to the next slide.
Sure.
Make that just a little bit bigger. So most of this I can just do from memory. I just created slides simply because there's a lot of material here that really supports what the process that we have and dictates that. So essentially, Minnesota State Statute defines and governs the handling of dangerous or potentially dangerous dogs. State statute also grants local jurisdictions such as ourselves, cities, the authority to regulate dangerous animals. So with that, local jurisdictions can be more restrictive than state statute. A lot of the rules regarding dangerous animals are laid out in state statute, but in addition to those, local jurisdictions can be more restrictive, and you see that very commonly in cities, and they do vary. as I mentioned here. So in Minnesota, we're all bound by state statute. However, the ordinances do vary, I would say, not necessarily greatly, but there are differences based on unique situations. And it's important to keep in mind as we go through this to remember that most ordinances aren't just created because we like creating ordinances, but rather because we've run into issues that weren't able to be resolved because there was a lack of regulation or restrictions. And so as a result of something that in most cases has already occurred, ordinances oftentimes either get written or rewritten or amended to address very specifically the issues going on in that community. Next slide, please. So with that, I'm not going to bore you with all the definitions. I just think it's important to understand that state statute is where the definitions come from. You'll see a lot of this language in our ordinance. Much of it reflects word for word what is in the state statute. And so essentially there's two classifications when we're looking at dogs. And they are, well, you have the dog that hasn't had any issues, it hasn't bitten anyone, it hasn't attempted to bite anyone, so there's no classification needed there. So there, beyond that, there's two classifications. Dangerous dog, and I'm doing this in this order because this is the order they're in state statute, is the higher level. This is the more dangerous dog. And there's essentially three ways you can get there. It's entirely possible to go from a dog that hasn't bitten anyone to the top level or dangerous dog classification in one incident if the damage inflicted creates a substantial bodily harm. In other words, significant injury or damage. The other way is if they kill a domestic animal without provocation is always the key on the owner's property, on the dog owner's property. And then the third one is the most common that we see is where a dog that has already bitten someone and is already labeled as or classified as potentially dangerous bites again. They become, then they move up to the next level and become a dangerous dog. So the next slide, I'll warn you, it's a little graphic, not too bad. I tried to pick something fairly mild. The only reason I put this in here is to give an idea of what does substantial bodily harm constitute. What is that? So this is a pretty significant injury. If you have to go to the doctor and you have a broken bone or you need stitches, that's gonna qualify as substantial harm. So that's a pretty awful looking wound. We can go to the next slide and bring that up to gross anyone out, but just to kind of demonstrate my point of there's different levels. So the next one is potentially dangerous. Now this is really the one that we deal with the most. Those severe injuries are fortunately very rare. We don't see a lot of those. They do happen, but they're fairly rare. The ones that we deal with most commonly are the potentially dangerous dog level, where you can see there's a couple ways you get to that. When unprovoked, again, is the key. The dog inflicts bites on a human or domestic animal on public or private property. It doesn't matter if it's on public property or private property. And so that's a pretty low standard, as you can see by state statute. And we get a number of these, as I mentioned. The others I won't really go into because they're not relevant to the discussion tonight, but there's other ways that a dog can become potentially dangerous, even without biting, if it's aggressive and consistently aggressive. Although for the purpose of discussion tonight, really that first one is the one we're talking about. The next slide, Brian, just shows it doesn't take a whole lot to be considered a dog bite. And this is a mandatory reporting situation. So if someone were to go to the clinic or the ER or urgent care, even with a wound like that, it looks really minor. They're mandated to report that to police. And so based on that, we have to take action. And that's based on state statute. So the next slide, this state statute is simply the one that just talks about giving cities the authority to regulate potentially dangerous and dangerous dogs. So I won't spend much time on that. I've already talked about that. Next slide, please, Brian. We have a city ordinance. It just happens to be 1110 that addresses animals of all kinds. There is a section of that that's specific to dangerous animals potentially dangerous animals. The statute talks about dogs. Our ordinance expands a little bit to include other animals as well. Much of this section, as I mentioned earlier, refers directly to the state statute or is the exact same language. All right, let's go to the next slide right now. This is a section of our ordinance that simply, I guess, addresses an officer responding to a complaint by ordinance and state statute, has the authority to go on the property and investigate, and if need be, impound the dog. You can go to the next slide there. So this section talks specifically about biting animals, and I think the point of contention in most of these types of cases is really the impoundment of the animal. I don't think we get a whole lot of questions or concerns when it comes to the rest of it because it's pretty clear cut. This is the piece that I think causes people the most anxiety, and with good reason, because certainly when you have pets, the last thing you want to happen is to have them taken away from you for a period of 10 days. The 10 days is in state statute. That's the minimum time that a dog has to be quarantined in order to essentially determine if they have any disease that's going to cause the bite victim any issues. So within 10 days, if something's going to develop, it will. So that's how the experts decided on 10 days. That's not something that we came up with in our ordinance, but is written in the state statute. Our ordinance is very specific in that it says that any animal that has bitten any person wherein the skin has been punctured or the services of a doctor are required shall be quarantined. So the word shall is mandatory. If it said may, we'd have some discretion. It says shall. And I think that there are a lot of people that think that that might be too harsh. And so I guess from my perspective, I think we always want to err on the side of safety. The process is really about protecting the victim. We still are concerned about treating the animal well and the families, both of the victim and the families of the animal. But ultimately, the process is designed around protecting the victim and being able to tell them at the end of 10 days that absolutely undeniably that this dog has been monitored, it's been quarantined, and you have absolutely nothing to worry about. If you're not familiar with the process for rabies shots, that is a horrible process for a human being to have to go through if there's doubt about whether or not whatever they got bitten by had rabies. If you have to go that through that series of treatments, it's excruciating. So I think this piece is very important to be able to tell them that they don't have anything to worry about. Let's see, we can go to the next slide. We do have a provision in our current ordinance that allows for a home quarantine. However, that is limited only when the victim is a family member. And I think the reason for this, you see this commonly, is that when the victim is a family member, obviously the family has a vested interest in making sure that the quarantine is done in the first place and it's done correctly, and they're very likely to cooperate. Now, that's not saying that people don't cooperate when it's not a family member. It's just much more difficult to track that and to ensure that the quarantine is done properly outside of a family setting. And so our ordinance, as I mentioned earlier, city ordinances across the state do vary a bit. There are many cities that do allow home quarantines. There are many that do not. I can tell you that over the years, this has, the current ordinance, while some people have contested it, has worked very, very well, because ultimately, like I said, this is in place to protect the victim, and there's nothing, victims are very happy to know that the dog was quarantined in a place that is run by professionals and it's monitored very closely. There's no question that the dog got out or got away or wasn't monitored for a couple of days out of the 10, and at the end, the dog owner can have their dog back and the victim can go away knowing there's no issues. And so other than the bite victim being a family member, there's no provision in our ordinance for home quarantine. All dogs that bite, if they cause puncture or need medical attention, get impounded and go through this 10-day quarantine it isn't our facility, but at the facility that we contract with. So we can go to the next slide. As I mentioned, we don't have our own facility here, of course. It's very staff intensive, so we contract with Crossroads Animal Shelter in Buffalo. We have done that for a number of years. They are a licensed facility, and as such, they're very familiar with the process and the requirements associated with taking in impounded dogs and quarantined dogs, which is vitally important to us because we need to ensure that that process is followed to the T in order to be able to report back to victims that that process was followed. It's kind of like a chain of custody, if you will. You don't want any holes in it because then at the end you just can't say with certainty that, that anything was followed. So that's why it's so important that, that we follow the system we do. I also think it's important to point out that Crossroads is a facility that's used by many law enforcement agencies, not just us, and there are not a lot of them available, to be honest. I shouldn't say every few years, but we have many times over the years looked for at other options. We used to kennel our dogs in a different location, which no longer exists, and there just aren't a lot of them. So Crossroads is one of the newer facilities out there, and it's, I guess, relatively close considering some of the others that would be available but are even further away. Okay, next slide, Brian. This is just a little snapshot to give you an idea. We don't get a huge number of these every year, about a dozen a year. My guess is that number will continue to increase as our population increases. And as activities within our city increases, we don't, not all of these occur at homes that are in our city. Sometimes people bring dogs in to parks or what have you, and it occurs in our city, but they don't live here. So this is very likely based on trends to continue to go up. It's been pretty stable the last few years, but as people continue to come in to town, that number will likely go up. Next slide, please, Brian. This is just a bunch of facts, and I think I just threw this in here just to give you an idea of dog bites are not, while they're not a huge issue for us, about a dozen a year is certainly more than we care to deal with, but it's a fairly manageable number. But across the nation, you can see the numbers, 4.7 million dog bites a year. This is a big deal. Most of the dogs that do the biting, they're either biting relatives or friends. Half of them occur on the property owner's property. They're not off the property. One in six dog bites require medical attention. I think it's important to point out there's nearly 80 million dogs owned in the U.S. So this is the potential is huge if we don't manage it well. So with that, I think the bottom one, dog bite injuries account for more than one-third of all liability claims against homeowners insurance. And that's the liability both for the homeowner and for us handling these types of complaints is there's a potential for a lot of liability with this. And so, again, I know that it sometimes may appear to be a bit harsh, but in the end, it's vitally important that we can tell a victim without a doubt that this dog has been in quarantine properly and that there's nothing to worry about from a liability standpoint. The other thing I think I'll point out about home quarantines, in most cases they go well, but they're very difficult for staff to monitor. The ordinance certainly would allow us to go and monitor that, but realistically, with the level of staff we have, that's just not realistic. We certainly stop in and verify in the first place and in the end, but as far as in the middle, when they're at a facility like Crossroads, they're monitored all the time. The other thing is if home quarantines are not necessarily, they're not secure. And that's an area of concern as well. And so even in the case of a family victim, we don't always allow it because if they don't have the means to quarantine a dog properly, then that just isn't allowed. So with that, we can go to the last slide. So last slide is again just kind of a recap that ultimately state statute and city ordinance is the goal of it is to protect the victim ideally or most importantly. It's also to provide a clear and consistent process. And for me, that's being in law enforcement for over 20 years, process is important. When you have systems and process, you're getting it right because you're doing it the same way every time. And that doesn't mean that we can't take into account varying circumstances and situations. Absolutely, we need to do that. But with that said, again, it's really about protecting the victim while still trying to make sure that we are treating the dog well as well. So I guess I've rambled on long enough, so I certainly stand for any questions or comments if you have any, and we'll go from there.
Any questions the council has? I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I'm going to read just a portion of the letter that we received. I know Ms. Spalding wanted to talk and felt that maybe she wanted to talk and really feel comfortable addressing the council in an open meeting forum. So I said I would read the letter. I'll read a great portion of it. It's, because of the recent experience, she's asking us to make changes to the ordinance regarding dog bites. I believe these changes would better serve the community, providing a result that would make the community safer and be more humane in respect to the treatment of the dogs as well. I'd like to request the wording of the ordinance be changed to allow for the police to use their professional judgment as to when a dog is quarantined after a bite has occurred, as well as to allow the officers on the scene to be able to use their judgment as to whether dog involved is a dangerous dog based on the specifics of each incident and the dog's history. And she goes on to say that these are in line with some of the other guidelines by other cities, especially Minneapolis. I'm going to skip over the next part, and then it says, the attachment above includes city codes from Mount Delano, Waconia, and Chaska as it applies to this issue. I would also like to suggest the idea that police officers be allowed to use their judgment in the treatment of the offending dog after the quarantine period has completed. The use of training for behavioral modifications and temperament testing by licensed dog training professionals could be used to mediate the classification of a dog as to be a dangerous, and that by the use of such training and or testing to remove or change the classification of the dog. In addition, I believe there should be an opportunity for individuals to be heard by an arbitrator or a judge who would have the authority to modify the judgments based on the evidence provided. I was unable to find it in the city code, so I'd like to know if the city of Minnetrista has a way for us to go before an arbitrator or a judge for reconsideration of the designation of potentially dangerous dog, as my father-in-law's dog must now be kept in a containment area in the house or on a leash while taken to the containment area outside. So I don't believe that we have the opportunity for arbitration and so on in our city. Is that correct?
Madam Mayor, that is correct. For potentially dangerous dog, that's not something that's currently done. We don't have any allowances for that.
Okay, but we do for dangerous dogs then,
for
right?
Dangerous dogs, we do.
Okay.
That's okay. A much higher level though.
All right. And then if a dog is deemed potentially dangerous, do they then have to keep the dog in the house all the time?
Madam Mayor, no, they don't. There's, in state statute, it spells out what the requirements are, as well as in our city code, which is essentially a reflection of state statute. So they have to be able to keep the pet contained, and there's a number of things that define what that is.
So you could have invisible fence, for instance.
Not invisible fence. It would have to be a physical fence.
Okay.
So a physical fence, for example, the dog can be outside with a person on a 6-foot leash.
Okay.
It could be in a house, but not with, you know, screen windows between it. It would have to be secure. So there are a number of options, but typically what we see people do in this case is they put up, for example, a cyclone fence or some kind of a secure fence area for the dog to be in.
Okay, and so again, we have to abide minimally by state statute, but we can create more restrictive codes.
That is correct, and currently the only area where we have become more restrictive in our ordinance than state statute is the impoundment piece.
Okay, whether they can impound it at home or
correct.
Or at a facility.
That is correct. Okay. And that, as I mentioned earlier, it was really out of necessity from years ago. I don't have a specific example of home quarantine or quarantine that just didn't happen or didn't happen properly.
Okay. And then Ms. Spalding goes on to talk about the kennel and felt that it wasn't good for the dog because of the situation. The kennel was a separated concrete and steel kennel with only a single blanket. And the dog wasn't able to go outside. Just for my information, you said it was a licensed facility, so they have to meet certain standards, I am assuming?
Madam Mayor, that is my understanding, and I'm by no means an expert on their facility, but they are a licensed facility, and I am told that, according to them and others that use the facility and the process, the dogs are being treated humanely. So I know that there's a lot of opinion surrounding that. I know my dog at home wouldn't really like to lay on a cement floor because he's not used to that, but nonetheless, by the state standards and the experts, if you will, in the Humane Society business, that is absolutely acceptable for that period of time.
Right. They go on to say, talk about beyond the fact that the dog was kenneled and not able to leave the kennel, not allowed by any contact and not allowed to leave the kennel for 10 days and was forced, wasn't able to go outside. And this isolation was not warranted by the specifics of the incident. And I'm going to give this letter to our administrator, and then he can also add it into the record, so it's part of the record. They just would like us to, they're asking if we would consider changes to our ordinance. This evening, we're not going to make any decision on this. The only thing I think we need to do is tell staff if we're interested in making any changes to our existing ordinance. If so, then they would bring it back at a later date. And if you feel that our ordinance is currently good as is, then we don't need to discuss it further. But I think that's what staff is just looking for tonight. And if you have any other comments that you would like to make, I'll give you a brief opportunity to do so.
Hi, okay. I'm Lori Spalding. I live at 2501 County Road 92, and thank you for reading my letter. One thing I didn't include in that letter is we do understand the need for these ordinances. We understand the seriousness of all dog bites, regardless of the infliction, and we understand that's our responsibility as dog owners to have our dogs under control and trained. I guess it's just a broad stroke of a rule to treat all dogs' bites the same. I just think of, like, what if that was our six-month-old puppy that had done that, which dogs playing, you know, could do that. Probably it happens with family. But if a puppy would go through 10 days of that kind of treatment, I just would find that hard to believe that that is what our council wants our citizens to experience. The thing about Crossroads is it's interesting that there's not many places, and that's unfortunate. It is like 22 miles from St. Bonnie, but probably for us the big thing was it's not open, it's closed to the public 4 days a week. It's only open on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And when you love your dog and it's in that situation, that's a difficult thing also. But I didn't know there wasn't many around. So.
Yeah, not a lot of options.
So yeah. Thank you for considering.
Okay, thank you. I know this can be very emotional for dog owners if they run into a situation like this, and certainly we don't wish it on anybody, and we also have to not only think about the dog owners, but we also have to think about victims and potential victims and safety in our city. And I know you understand that. So any comments, or what is your pleasure?
I got one question for Paul. The way it sounds, it's state statute, so we couldn't change it if we wanted to, could we?
Madam Mayor, members of council, There are probably, as far as the quarantine part of it, we certainly could change that. Like I said, I don't recommend that, and that might sound harsh. I think it's important that, I guess I'll back up, and I want to point out that we do evaluate each case on a case-by-case basis. And as you mentioned, the example you used of a puppy, I've had dogs all my life, so I'm very familiar with dogs. Some of our officers are not. And when you start creating situations where you have different people looking at, do you impound it, do you not, that gets difficult. When you have a process, it makes it a lot easier. However, the evaluation process up front, certainly we're going to look at that and evaluate that. In this particular case, without giving up too many details, this is not a case of a puppy. This is a case of a full-grown dog that bit a garbage man. So very unfortunate, and I've spoken with a number of your family members and about this, and I understand your concern. I really do. But I'm torn because my job is public safety, and so As I mentioned when I was speaking with some of them, that I'm always going to err on the side of safety, and so that's my job.
Yep.
And if I don't do that, then I think I'm falling short of what I'm supposed to be doing. And so, but we do evaluate each case on a case-by-case basis, and certainly in the case of a puppy, I think, you know, unprovoked or what was the intent, or how did it happen? These happen a lot of times, and oftentimes they don't even rise to this level. So that does happen, and I think the system does catch that. They're not all treated absolutely identical.
And, you know, I think that's a good point. I think the reason I also asked to have it brought here is because, you know, this does happen in our city. It happens, you know, several times, like Ms. Chief Falls pointed out, about a dozen times a year. And how many of us here know what the ordinance is and know why this happens and how and what the process is? And there are a lot of dogs in our community. But the other lesson I think that is learned here, not only for us or for dog owners throughout our city, is we have to keep our dogs on leashes. We have to keep them within our voice command. Now, obviously, this was on their property. The dog did not leave their property. But I think it's just a good idea to kind of revisit these things and kind of look at them and make sure that everybody is safe and that we are treating the dogs as best we possibly can. That's why I was asking about the licensing of the kennel, and I did ask you if there's other facilities close by. So we really don't have a lot of the options in that regard. So,
Council Member Vanderlyn, did I answer your question to your satisfaction?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any other comments?
Just a thought. I don't know to what degree it's valid. It's not something that we can do about it, I don't think, but as a dog owner myself, but you know, we kennel our dog when we excuse me, when we travel. I'm not choked up, I just when we travel, there are times where we don't see our dog for many days, you know, so but if it was this situation, you would want your own dog to be handled as humanely as possible and be able to visit the dog. And I don't know to what degree you can bring any of the dog's personal belongings there for them, just so that not to cause additional distress for the dog. But that wouldn't be our decision. That would be, I think, the decision of wherever they're being kenneled, just like if you know, kennel your dog when you travel. Some places let you leave some things and some don't, but.
Right.
Correct. I did have a conversation with Crossroads regarding very specifically this situation, and the family was concerned because they were essentially being told that they shouldn't visit the dog. The conversation I had with the staff member there was that they don't recommend that because they say it's actually harder on the dog to go visit and then leave than it is just to leave the dog alone for that period of time. Mm-hmm. Again, that's a matter of, that's based on their professional opinion, and I'm not a dog expert, but many families do want to go and visit, and so they did, after our conversation, as I understand it, made provisions for that to happen. They allowed them to bring, I don't know if a dog bed or whatever it was. As far as the, it's difficult when your dog's used to getting out of a space when they're not allowed to go outside, and again, that's because of the quarantine period. They have to be able to ensure that dog doesn't get away. So my guess is at some point they probably did allow that, and what happens when that dog gets away? And now we can't answer to the victim.
Yeah.
And so the rules are fairly strict, but unfortunately they're there in place because they're trying to protect the victim.
Okay. All right.
Could I?
Just real quick, yes.
There is some. My father-in-law takes his dog to the St. Bonnie Pet Hospital for all the shots, would be that record. But the definition of provoked or unprovoked, it seemed like some of the ordinances allowed for the person to go before a judge to kind of defend their story or have the opportunity for due process to have their side to determine whether a dog was provoked or not. Rather than just being one person's decision on what the situation was. And I was just wondering, so there's no ability in this council or in this city to have that arbitrator or someone hear the case?
We don't have a process for that as far as the potentially dangerous dog level. Certainly, when we initially take the report, if there's a question as to whether it was provoked or not provoked, we would have that discussion at that point. Absolutely. And if there's question about it, I don't know that I personally would want to move forward with a case on a potentially dangerous dog if in fact that was in question itself. In this particular case, I don't know that there's, in my opinion, reviewing the case, no question, because it literally bit the garbage man. So it's a bit different.
Well, I think our family has a different opinion on that.
Sure.
Right.
Well, we're not going to take up a lot more time tonight. I'm not seeing a huge, I don't think the council is in agreement to change the ordinance. I would say let's monitor it, though, see how others react maybe or whatever, but we'll just kind of keep tabs on it. It's certainly not perfect. I don't think any ordinance is perfect, but it's also not a good idea to start changing ordinance based on one incident. And this, I've been on the council for many years. I was previously a council member for 12 years and now mayor for almost two. And this is the first time I've encountered the dog ordinance, biting ordinance and issues with it. So I so far it's been working, and maybe we can just make sure that dogs are being kenneled properly and that they're being taken care of. But like I said, we also have to make sure that victims are also, that we're concerned about them as well. And I know you understand that. So with that, thank you, Mr. Falls, and also thank you for bringing some of this stuff to our attention as well. So we will now move on to persons to be heard. We have somebody signed up, but I did speak to her earlier, and she said she was here just to observe and listen, so we really don't have anybody. Next, we'll move on to our consent agenda items. I would like to remove item number 4H. Is there any other consent agenda items that you wish to remove?
Mayor, I would request that we remove item 4E for council discussion.
Okay, so we have item 4E and 4H to be removed from the consent agenda items. Any other removals? We already deleted K, so that's done. Otherwise, we have consent agenda item A, approve our work session meeting minutes from July 18th, 2016. Approve our closed work session meeting minutes from July 18th, 2016. Approve our regular meeting minutes from July 18th, 2016. A lot of minutes to approve here. And then approve our claims. And then number F is authorize and execute transfers approved in 2016 budget amendments. And G is a resolution to approve simple subdivision between 4340 Highland Road and 4275 Creekview Circle. And then number I is a resolution to accept the resignation of Jessica Archer, who is our current building official. And J is a resolution to approve assignment of general fund balances for 2017 budget purposes. Is there a motion to approve A, B, C, D, F, G, I, and J?
So moved.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, motion has been made by Ms. Mortensen and seconded by Vander Linde to approve consent agenda items as listed. All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion passes. I'll just start real quick with mine, Ms. Stoll, and then I'll move on to you. The reason I wanted to approve, I wanted to pull the approve the status change from probationary to full-time for Cassandra Tabor of HR Communications Coordinator is because I just wanted to say a few words stating that she has been a wonderful, fabulous employee. I have had the opportunity and the pleasure of working with Cassandra for many months now, as has staff. She's done a fabulous job, and I commend her for it. She's always been willing to do whatever the council wants her to do, and she's come through with flying colors, and I sure hope she stays on for a lot longer, and maybe many more years. And so with that, I'll make a motion to approve the status change from probationary to full-time for Cassandra Tabor, who is our HR Communications Coordinator. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
All right. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those in favor? All those opposed? Motion passes. 5-0. Next, Ms. Thole, you wanted to remove, approve a front yard setback variance for 5885 Loring Drive.
Yes. I just thought that there were a couple of items that I wanted to make sure that the homeowner was aware of, and also just thought that that there was a couple of components to it also that, as opposed to it just going through as a consent agenda item, that should be discussed. First of all, I wanted to just double check as far as if you were going to be adding a driveway onto Maple Forest, which, as you're the homeowners?
Yeah.
Okay.
Why don't you come up and state your name and address for the record, please? Thank you.
Dale Klaus, 5885 Loring Drive.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. Loring Drive, the homes that aren't on the lakeside of the street, which is you, are a member of an association where you have lake access to boat slips. I think that there's a waiting list right now, possibly, but my concern was if your driveway is on Maple Forest, will that switch you over into, I think they also have an association, that I'm not sure of, but
There is a Maple Forest Homeowners Association, and we did check with the president of that association, and he indicated just because we're putting in access for Maple Forest, that would not mean that we were eligible to become members of that association, mm-hmm. and that would not be our intent. Our intent is to keep the front entrance, the Loring Drive entrance, our main entrance. Mm-hmm. Interestingly, the aspect of the house that attracted us to that property is some very interesting topography.
I'm familiar with it,
yes.
Yeah.
And that also creates some challenges from mm-hmm. a design standpoint. Specifically, access to our garage.
Yes.
From Loring Drive.
Which is dangerous.
Which is dangerous because mm-hmm. there's a fairly steep
retaining wall.
Right.
Yeah.
And a retaining wall that needs to be replaced. And so emergency services, friends and family, we would, our intent is for them to approach the house as is now mm-hmm. from Loring Drive. Mm-hmm. That would be the kind of the main entrance. And the back Maple Forest entrance would be for us for access to our garage.
Mm-hmm.
So your address would remain Loring Drive?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yep. The right-of-way or the land on Maple Forest that would that goes on that side of your property, there's a fairly significant amount of land there that's city land or right-of-way, which is full of brush, overgrown trees, you know.
Yeah.
As who would be responsible for maintaining that part of the property as you would see it?
As we would see it, it would be us. We actually, in fact, my wife, Sue, is nuts about landscaping.
Oh, okay.
We understand that, that portion of the property is city property, mm-hmm. but we would take that as our responsibility to maintain it, to make sure that it looks good, as well as the kind of the entire stretch of Maple Forest, which is much of our property. I think it, as you kind of implied, I think it could be cleaned up and
you could hardly make it worse. Okay, the public land, emergency responders, we talked about that. I guess, and maybe my greater concern is I understand your desire for that driveway off of Maple Forest. It makes sense to me that that would be the front of the house. I mean, the house is pretty parallel with Maple Forest, and then you do have that steep driveway. And I just want us as a council to be mindful of, do we grant people two driveways on their property, and I believe that one of the comparisons that was used is there's another home down on Maple Forest and County Road 44, right on the corner there, that has two driveways, but I don't know, but it would be my guess that the first driveway that existed was on County Road 44, and then from a safety perspective, the city probably allowed a driveway to be made on Maple Forest, and so then therefore they have two driveways, but
I think that would be a question of the planner. I think we do allow two driveways as long as they have the frontage.
Nothing currently prohibits the addition of a second driveway.
Yeah.
Okay. As long as it is in line with the hardcover?
Correct, yep. This property currently sits at about 12.5%. A lot of the work is going to be repurposing existing hardcover. There's going to be a little bit additional with that second driveway, but not enough to get to the 25% maximum they're allowed.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Christians?
I have two questions. One, Dale, how long have you lived there?
We closed in March.
Just this last year?
Yes.
Okay. And my second question is, are there any other accesses, or would this be the only one that would have two accesses? Are there any other properties that are on Loring Drive and Maple
Forest? No, this is a unique, because they're kind of on a corner. It's sort of like
the shape of the property, too, that is distinct.
So there's not a potential issue of setting a precedence of having other neighbors down the road?
Not on Loring Drive.
That's not an issue?
I would say no. The only issue that I thought of is some have a garage in the back. You have your garages in the front, but then you have your lake garage, and if anybody wanted to pave around so that they could drive down to that, but then I think that
there
probably wouldn't, that the hardcover would probably restrict that.
So this would be the only one on the order that would be actually on Maple Forest. I was just thinking about, are we not, that we don't set a precedence?
Exactly, yeah, and whether it be on Loring Drive or Maple Forest or another street in Minnetrista, but you are really the only house until you get down to the one on the corner of County Road 44,
right,
other than the fact that there's a cul-de-sac there, and then those people are
lake. There really isn't. That's really not a possibility,
okay,
because of the fact that we own a large section from our house to almost to 44, to that property that you're describing,
okay,
is our property. So our house is the only one with potential access to Maple Forest.
And the only reason they have to have the variance is because of the city-owned outlot, if you will. That's what the variance is for.
Right.
So it meets setback requirements. It's not close to other houses. It's just odd because of that outlot, and that's where the variance comes into play. So, all right.
Can I also say that we're very excited about becoming members of the Minnetrista community. Interestingly, we were not looking for property or looking to move. We have a house that we're in the process of selling in Minnetonka currently, and we were looking for property for our son and his wife, and we came across that property and fell in love with it. So we're looking to make Minnetrista our long-term home, and we love the community and love the property and hope to improve it and improve the value of the neighborhood.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Welcome. So, okay. So with that, I think the Planning Commission did vote to approve it on a 5-0 basis. They discussed a lot of these issues, as Ms. Thole has brought up, and felt it was fine to go ahead and approve the variance. And like I said, the variance is basically not of their own doing, it's the outlot. So if that wasn't there, they'd be perfectly fine. So anyway, with that. Any other questions? Otherwise, I'm looking for a motion to approve the front yard setback variance at 5885 Loring Drive.
I will make a motion to approve the front yard setback variance at 5885 Loring Drive.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second that.
All right, a motion has been made and seconded. Is there any further discussion or questions? Hearing none, all those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, motion passes 5-0. I'm sorry, Mark, I didn't hear you.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. 5-0. All right, thank you. So your variance has been approved. And welcome to Minnetrista.
Yes.
So, all right. Public hearings. We have one public hearing, and that is an ordinance to establish for establishment of a Water Street Stormwater Improvement Tax District. And then we'll also do an ordinance by title and summary. We've done this before, and we should be familiar with this. It's been now typical that when a new development is approved, we do a taxing district over it immediately so that in the future we have opportunities if need be. So maybe Nick or Mr. Beatty?
Madam Mayor, Council, that's exactly what I was going to say. Mm-hmm. This is, as we've described it before, sort of a belts and suspenders approach that we've now been taking for a number of years. Whenever there's a subdivision, we require the developer to build and take care of the stormwater improvements. Typically, that responsibility is then passed on to the homeowners association. What we put in place through the development agreement is a possibility that if that fails, in other words, if the developer, or more likely the HOA, fails to take care of those improvements, the city always has the right to go in and do so. We have a couple of options. One is special assessments, where we need to find benefit. But we've utilized this tool now for probably 10 years or so. We create a tax district, which just sort of lies there. It doesn't go into effect, but it does allow the city, if need be, to make those improvements and then to recover the cost of that through a tax levied only against the properties within the subdivision, not citywide. And the benefit of doing that rather than a special assessment is that there's no need to show benefit. So again, we've been doing a number of these. We've never had to implement one. I've been doing them in other cities for probably 20 years, and I'm happy to say I've never had to implement one anywhere, but I just think it's a good insurance policy and a good habit that we've gotten into.
Right. Thank you. Any questions of Mr. Beatty? I think it's pretty straightforward. We've done it before. So this is a public hearing, so I will at this time open the public hearing. If there's anybody here that wishes to speak for or against creating this stormwater improvement tax district, may do so at this time. I don't see anybody rushing to the podium, so I will close the public hearing. Close the public hearing at this time and take it back to the council. Normally we would hold a public hearing at the Planning Commission, but this was, we're doing it here tonight. So we have met the requirements by holding our public hearing, and now we can move forward to approve ordinance number 441, which will establish a Watershed Stormwater Improvement Tax District, and it's resolution number 146-16.
So moved.
Okay, Ms. Thole made the motion and Mr. Van der Linde seconded. All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, motion passes. And we're going to publish it by title and summary. Do you need a special or separate motion for that?
Yes.
Okay, so I need a motion to, an ordinance to,
Resolution,
I'm sorry, number 146 ordinance to publish it by title and summary. Is there a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Okay, is there a second?
Second it.
Okay, Ms. Mortensen made the motion, Ms. Thole seconded that. All those in favor signify with aye.
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 Aye. All those opposed, motion passes. So next, we're moving on to our business items, and we have accept quotes and award contract for our fall seal project. Fog seal project for city project 08-16, Mr. Hornby.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. If you recall this project, we had a fog seal improvement included in the crack fill and seal coat project, but I think there's some confusion of the contractors that bid on it. We had a wide variance in the bids received, so the council did not award that portion of the crack fill and seal coat project. So we just separately went out for quotes. The lowest bid during the crack fill and seal coat project was $7,7200, something like that. The lowest quote that we did receive is for $5,290. The fog seal is for the trails. There is a map in your packet that shows the park trails that would be parks and trails that would be included in the fog seal. There's also a resolution 147-16. If you would award, if you want to consider award, we would recommend approving that resolution, accepting quotes, and awarding the 2016 fog seal improvement project to Ally Blacktop Company for their low bid of $5,290.
Have you worked with Ally Blacktop in the past?
Yes, Ally has done Cragfield and Seal Coat projects around here and, you know, actually for the city of Minnetrista as well.
Okay, so they're reputable.
Long-standing.
And they'll do a good job.
Mm-hmm.
All right, thank you. Any other questions? Otherwise, is there a motion to approve this resolution, 147-16?
So moved.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second that.
All right, motion has been made and seconded to approve resolution number 147-16, which is accepting the quotes and award contract to Ally Blacktop Company in the amount of $5,290. Any further questions or discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, motion passes 5-0. So next we'll move on to our ordinance on number 440, which is our temporary housing ordinance, or to opt out of the state ordinance. Law, go ahead.
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor, members of council. This item here is in response to legislation passed down by Governor Dayton on May 12th of 2016. As you'll recall, this item was presented at a council work session on June 20th for discussion. From that discussion, you directed staff to draft an ordinance opting out of the requirement. This ordinance here does that. It has been presented to the Planning Commission. They have recommended approval of this ordinance along with staff. There is no need for title and summary on this ordinance as it is short enough to be published in its entirety.
Okay. Again, it's pretty short, pretty straightforward. We can opt out. The only, and I'll just make a couple comments because I was at the Planning Commission. They did have some discussion on whether or not the city wanted to allow some of this in the rural areas. That would have to be addressed later if that's something the city is interested in, because we are under a time frame right now. In order to opt out of this, we have to pass an ordinance prior to September 1st. Okay, thank you. And so this would be our last meeting in which we could pass this ordinance. If we wanted to look at something allowing some type of temporary housing in a rural area, and that's what the commission was looking at or we asking, then we could do that at a later time. So, what is your pleasure, council?
I would say we proceed with opting out. And Mike Baroni, I think you said this. It is a kind of an experiment.
Yep.
And I think it would be wise to let the experiment run for a time and then relook at it once any kinks
are. Yeah, I don't think there's all that. Mayor and Council, I don't believe there's too many cities that have gone for this particular ordinance. So, as you mentioned, you know, we can sit back and kind of watch the communities that do, and if so desire, we could change it in the future. So, for now, we'll just.
Exactly.
Yeah, we have, what is it, the. We already have the guest house something, so we already kind of have it in a way.
Something similar, yes.
We have a guest house,
yeah,
right?
So we're fine, I think.
Ordinance. So actually what we're doing is we're creating a new ordinance, number 440, for temporary housing. It's opting out, but it's basically creating a new housing ordinance. So, questions? Okay, motion. Thank you. Is there a motion to pass ordinance number 440 for temporary housing and opting out of the state legislative?
So moved.
Okay, motion has been made by Mr. Vanderlinde. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Motion has been seconded by Ms. Mortensen. All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, motion passes 5-0. Thank you very much, and that will be published in its entirety. Next, we're moving on to approving an after-the-fact variance at 1155 Cove Circle.
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor, members of council. This item here, if you'll recall, a couple years ago, they did apply for a variance to the front setback to 20 feet. This was instituted because of the bluff setback requirement that shrunk the building pad of this property, and the most logical variance was to the front setback. So the applicant after that submitted for permit and proceeded with the permit in hand with the normal steps. They made it to their foundation. Their foundation went in and that survey was approved. And then following typical inspections and building review, they submitted their grading as-built survey. At that point, staff noticed an error in the setback requirements, which have been outlined in your staff report. The applicant is not here to, I guess, explain the situation, but I guess I'll explain it the best that I can. What happened was they made it to the foundation and they wanted to increase the, change some dynamics of the house. And what they did is they worked directly with our previous building inspector on that and did not notify the city of any changes. They assumed that since they were operating on the same foundation that they would be in the clear for the house, and that is not the case. The city does allow for some exceptions for cantilevering into the setback, but nothing that covers this specific case here. So when this error was noted, the staff contacted the applicant and told him that a variance would be required. That has been presented here tonight. It was previously at the Planning Commission. It was recommended approval 4-1, and staff is also recommending approval of that.
3-2. I think it was, wasn't 4-1? Okay.
It was 4-1.
Okay. Sorry.
Mr. Molitor was the one exception to that.
Yes, I'm sorry.
They also discussed the possibility of creating an after-the-fact fee, I guess, if you will, for variances when they're applied for after the fact. After the fact variances are actually very rare. Through my research in recent history, I only found one, and that was a few years ago, and it was for a minor correction, and that was found at the foundation. And that's why we do that survey, is to correct that. But in an instance like this, when the foundation survey passes and they cantilever to the setback, it is difficult to catch it until, unfortunately, the house is built. So.
Yeah. It kind of looks like, let's build it and then ask forgiveness later kind of issue.
Certainly does.
This didn't sit well with the planning commissioners. They really felt that this, a professional builder really knew what they were doing and should have known that they had to do the footprint versus going outside of the foundation. They knew that. And this was during that time where we were changing over from our contracted building official to our own building official, so there was some crossover there, and that's why it wasn't caught. Or
that is their explanation.
That is
whether
their explanation.
That is true or not. I guess I can't speak to that. That's where I wish the applicant was here to explain that situation.
But I think it's fair to say that all of the planning commissioners kind of felt like that we were duped, if you will. But the building is there, the house is there, most likely it's not going to be torn down. So I guess their recommendation is to approve the variance, but their question was, in the future, should we run up against something like this again? Mm-hmm. Is there some way that we can have a very hefty after-the-fact variance fee so that it will deter some builders from doing that? You can always defer the fee if it's a minor little thing that was totally not on purpose. But when this is so blatant, I mean, it is just seemingly quite blatant. I'm going to say seemingly blatant. Something like this really doesn't deserve the general typical fee that people pay. That's kind of how the planning commissioners looked at it.
And certainly we want to be careful or mindful of those type of situations. They were, from what I'm seeing here, and tell me if I'm looking at the wrong information, the difference that they were off was
a foot and a half.
The largest is the front setback. That is the largest variation. The side setbacks are slight infringements on the requirements.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, because I'm seeing the side of just 0.4 inch.
And that's consistent with the one I've seen before.
Yeah, which that...
Less than half a foot.
But they're a foot and a half on one of them.
Yeah, they had a variance, they had a front yard variance, so that, a 15-foot front yard variance.
Correct.
And what they ended up with is going even further, another foot and a half. So, and they did that by not putting in a foundation under that foot and a half. They just cantilevered it.
Oh, it's cantilevered out.
Yes.
Correct.
Right.
The footprint is the same.
Yes.
The foundation footprint is the same.
Foundation.
The cantilevered footprint, if you will, is a little bit larger.
And that's not allowed by our ordinance, and it's and that's why it is what it is. But anyway. So two issues, obviously the variance in front of us, but I think Mr. Olson and Mr. Abel are in our planning department felt that it warranted at least for the council to be aware of this situation and aware of something like this. I think the Park Planning Commission felt the same. Like I said, most likely we're gonna have to approve it because otherwise they'd have to tear the house down. I mean, they're not gonna redo it. But then the second issue might be, do we want to, maybe at our January meeting when it comes with our fee schedule, could we add something in our fee schedule that would be steep enough and injurious enough that people may not do something like this again?
And at some point, I'd like to address the second piece of that.
Okay, let's do the first one. An after-the-fact variance application approval or not?
Yeah, I would make a motion to approve the after-the-fact variance of 1155 Cove.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any further questions or discussion?
I have one question. Did it cost the city anything to time-wise or anything to put this all together? And I mean, I don't know, reevaluating everything.
They did have to pay an after-the-fact variance fee.
Yeah, they paid the typical fee, which is the $300 fee plus a $300 deposit. They did pay that. Keep in mind, I mean, not quantifiable, they were delayed in time by about 6 weeks. So the house is done and ready to go, but they cannot get a certificate of occupancy until the house is approved in its existing location. So they have been costed that time in terms of trying to market and sell the house.
Is this a contractor that has done business with the city often in the past?
Not at least with my experience here. I have not. This is the first and only experience with them. I believe the owner of the company is at least owns property in Minnetrista. I don't know if he lives at that property, but he has been around Minnetrista in the past.
Is this something we could flag?
So this is... This is actually, it was an old house that was there. It was removed.
No, there was no
house. There was never a house there. What happened here was it was the last vacant lot in the Jennings Bay development.
Okay. Jennings Cove.
Jennings Cove, correct. Yeah. When the city instituted the bluff setback, it put a huge hardship on this property and, like I said, significantly shrunk the building pad. They applied in the past and were denied a variance.
Okay.
And then recently applied and were approved a variance.
Okay.
And like I said, during the change in inspections, they... according to them, abused that change to get a different plan that they thought was more desirable.
Okay.
So what you're saying is the chance of this happening again is pretty slim because we're not changing building officials every year.
Hopefully not.
Well, right. So, I mean, that's where the opportunity. So, I mean, normally,
in their mind, yes.
Right. If there's any modifications of cantilever, it has to be on the print. If it's not, it's got to be approved by the city. Now that the city's doing the building officials, chances are this is probably never going to happen again.
Yes, and like I said, with that, the requirement of the foundation as built, we do have our system of checks and balances. It's unfortunate in this situation when the checks checked off and the final product came out and it didn't meet that requirement.
Okay.
So, like I said, I mean, I think the last one that happened was 4 or 5 years ago, and I don't know when it happened before that. So I think that's why deterring a potential review of the fee until the fee schedule would be an appropriate
correct
application.
Right. Yeah, we're not, staff isn't recommending doing anything right now. So, and we can talk about that in more depth at a later work session, or did you want to make a comment?
Well, let me make a comment. You're right, several people have commented that if there were going to be a change in the fee, it would have to be reflected in the fee schedule. We can amend that anytime we want, but traditionally, we've done that in December,
right,
so that we have a new fee schedule applicable the following year. The issue about fees, or the essential point about fees, is that they are intended to recover costs, not to produce revenue.
Right.
And that's true in this context and in every context. The idea is that they're to make the city whole. And so that's why we vary fees depending on the complexity of the case, whether there's legal and engineering and other things, making people pay for the cost that they incur, but they're not intended to be revenue producers. So to the extent that that an after-the-fact variance is more complicated, involves more staff time, or incurs more cost on the city's part, then yes, those could be recovered. I don't think you could do it simply as a punitive measure, however.
Okay.
As much as we would.
I understand the frustration. Yeah. These things do come up, and it's often hard to prove. And I don't know the situations here, but there are times when you're pretty darn sure someone was trying to pull a fast one, and it's certainly tempting to try to slap them. But there really are severe limitations on what we can do through
sure.
a fee.
Yeah. And I think Ms. Thole pointed out, too, you know, there are some times where somebody makes an honest mistake and it's 3 feet, 3 inches or off or whatever. That's not what we're, you know, here to dispute. But anyway, with that, then, motion has been made and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed? Motion passes 5-0 to approve the after-the-fact variance at 1155 Cove Circle. So thank you very much, Ron, for those unencouraging words.
Trying to be realistic.
All right. Realistic words. Thank you. Next, we have a resolution to approve our drug task force contract.
I think that's going to be both
Is
Chief
that
Falls
you,
and
Chief?
Mr. Beatty.
Okay.
Madam Mayor, members of the council, as you know, we've been having discussions for some time regarding this position, and we're excited about being able to get someone into the drug task force. Certainly, as a matter of housekeeping, the contract that didn't include us prior to our involvement in that group needed to be amended and restated in order to include us. And so while going through that, our city attorney also found some housekeeping items, if you will, that he thought it would be a good idea to clean up as long as he was reviewing it anyway. And so before you tonight is that amended and restated contract that now includes us. So that is really the final step that we need to have happen in order to get our person into the task force.
Good. Okay. Any questions on the contract? I think I just had some. I did ask Chief Pauls. It says all directors shall serve at the pleasure of the appointing authority. So you would be a director on the board for the drug task force, I'm assuming? Or we would appoint you? Is that correct?
Essentially, that's what that means.
Okay.
I will be a member of the board as one of the participating agencies, as
okay.
the chief of the participating agencies.
And so with that, do we have to at some point, not at time, pass a resolution appointing you, officially appointing you? Because it doesn't say that the chiefs specifically are, but it does say that normally they are, but.
I think that would be a question.
Yeah, I think you could do it by resolution or motion.
Okay, all right. That's maybe another one for another evening, unless you want to do it tonight.
Well, I think you probably do it tonight. It goes into
okay.
the second motion. After
right.
Okay.
Madam Mayor, I guess my preference would be if that's a simple process, we just do it tonight and be done with it rather than have to bring
right.
that piece back.
That's fine then, good. Okay, that was my only comments. So with that, we've been working on this. This was one of our priorities for this year, so this is good to see it come to fruition. And is there a motion then? One, to approve the drug task force contract, and also with that, approve Chief Falls as our representative on the board.
So moved.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay, motion has been made and seconded, as stated. as stated. Any further questions or discussion?
All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, motion passes 5-0. And next, we're accepting bids and awarding the contract for the parking lot project in Lyle Park, and I believe that's Mr. Hornby.
Correct, Mayor and members of the council. We did open bids on August 9th for the Lyle Park parking lot improvement project. That project included a base bid and alternate bids. The base bid was for a 30-stall parking lot with a bituminous trail, stormwater drainage facility, stormwater erosion control permitting, and electrical system for parking lot lighting. There were a number of alternates A through D. Alternate A included an expansion of the parking lot from 30 to 60 stalls. Alternate B was a tennis court swale improvement. This is a swale, an existing drainage issue that was not addressed with the tennis court improvement at Lyle Park. Alternate C is a stormwater improvement, was to add a catch basin in an existing lower area along Hunter's Trail. So there's a low point catch basin that's not at the low point, so this would take care of that. Alternate D was a swale drainage improvement, essentially filling a low area adjacent to the park. There's a flared end section that drains a low area that's, the low area has become lower than the flared end, so the water doesn't drain dry. And there's a number of sump pumps that pump into that from the adjacent houses, so it's wet all the time. That's not as intended. So those alternates were included. We did receive a number of bids on that project. That's in your packet. There's a summary of those bids on page 130 of your packet. We received 4 bids. The lowest bid received was from Buck Blacktop. The base bid was $323,875. The total base bid plus all alternates was $424,175. So about $100,000 difference to double the size of your parking lot plus the alternates. Staff does recommend approving the resolution. That is resolution 150-16. Accepting the bids and awarding the Lyle Park parking lot improvement. This is for city project 05-16 to Buck Blacktop for the low bid. Their low bid is the base bid plus any council selected alternates. Staff does recommend, if you're looking at the alternates, that alternate A and alternate C should be considered if you don't want all of them.
When you say tennis court swale, where would that be?
And it's actually south of the tennis court, between the trail and the tennis court.
There's okay, so that has nothing to do with the parking lot.
No, all of these items are within area at the park. So they're park related, but they're not specifically related
to the parking lot. The only one would be alternate A, would be the parking lot.
Correct.
And the alternate D, swale drainage improvement, where would that be?
That's in the northwest portion of the park, adjacent to some new homes.
Okay.
I think there's 3 sump pumps, maybe 4, that discharge directly to that area. And so that area is always wet. It was intended to drain dry, but we are starting to get some plants that would resemble wetlands.
Mm-hmm.
And that wasn't the intent there.
Could those, and then the street stormwater improvement project, where would that be?
That is on Hunter's Trail. And that is on the southwest side of the park. This was something that, actually, all of these alternates were items that Public Works intended to take care of, other than alternate A, but haven't had the manpower to do those. So we added them in to this bid for the park to see if we can get them done that way.
Okay.
So what happens is there's a drainage issue on Hunter's Trail where the there is a catch basin, but it's not. It's no longer at the low point, so there's always some water ponding in the roadway, causes some icing issues in the winter, and also some inconvenience for people traveling that roadway in the summertime.
Staff, so if we did base bid and the alternate bids, that number would come out of park dedication funds, correct?
Other than the
The base bid?
The base bid and the alternate bid A, so for the parking lot expansion, that would come out of park dedication funds.
Correct.
Do we have enough in the funds to cover that? Is that part of the CIP for parks?
Correct, yeah. If you remember from earlier in the year, we had budgeted, I believe, $500,000 total for both parking lot as well as some playground equipment. I think the more we explored both the playground equipment and the parking lot, it made more sense to just take care of the, I think the parking lot was the more pressing need, plus we didn't have enough budgeted to, I think the $500,000 that's listed in the agenda item, the packet item there, wasn't gonna do both. So right. I think the parking lot, and from talking with Chief Falls and stuff and other staff was speaking with David Abel, was the one we wanted to explore, and that's where we would we'd have the dollars to do that, right. Budgeted for 2016, correct.
Okay.
And I think the mayor and council, I think the 30 versus 60 stalls, I think at the time we brought this up, that I think most council members are kind of leaning towards the 60, if I remember correctly, knowing that if you build 30 and just kind of leave the other chunk of the parking lot that would eventually be developed in the future, they're going to park there anyway. So kind of mess up whatever's there. So we thought, let's just, I think at the council's suggestion, go for alternate to add the additional 30 and see what that costs. So
the additional 30, the initial 30 is the $323,000?
Correct.
And the additional 30 is $57,386?
Mm-hmm. Right. So you can supersize the parking lot for an extra $57,000.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. That seems like kind of a no-brainer, but I'll let everybody else express their own opinion. To me, the tennis court swale, the swale drainage, I don't know that we need to pay extra for that if our public works can get out there and do that. And I question alternate C, the street stormwater, for $25,000. While that would be nice, we've got a lot of streets that probably have that issue that we have and continue in the next year to be putting a lot of money into Hunter's Crest with the park that's going in there. So I would like to see some of that money go to some of the other areas of Minnetrista as well. And so at this point, my opinion would be go with alternate A only.
Okay.
I'll make it short. A's a no-brainer. C, I think, is, if you don't get rid of the water, you're going to have problems, and that's part of the reason we've got some issues in the city, is we've got drainage issues. So I would do A and C.
Okay.
My question is, B, C, and D, is this something that
our public works can do?
They could, but I believe Mr. Hornby, you can probably correct me if I'm wrong, but I think right now it's just a staffing issue. So, and they've had some curveballs thrown at them this year the stuff, even with the staffing they have, especially with the spring weather that we had, crazy spring weather with all the rock and stuff. So this is not going to get done right away, but this was one way of getting it done, was to contract. And that holds true for a lot of things public works may or may not be able to do or get to. So we'll look for to farm it out to do things like this as well. Our cost are probably going to be similar, maybe not quite as expensive, but it's going to cost us staff time, materials, labor. So
maybe Brian, could you answer, would we have a few extra dollars in our stormwater fund? Because I'm assuming that portion of it, this $25,000, could it be taken from our stormwater funds?
I think even one of the budget amendments we brought back, there was actually, when all the projects were looked at, I think we did have some dollars left over, I guess net to the good, just from a pure financial standpoint.
Okay.
So yeah, I would think.
So you think C'd be okay?
I think I'd probably stop at C, I guess, or I don't know, and
okay.
Agree with I think what Mr. Hornby and Mr. Vanderlinde are saying. I'd probably do A and C.
Okay. All right.
The only question I have is, I'm not familiar with Buck Blacktop. Has the city ever worked with them before?
Well, that would be a question for Mr. Hornby.
I have not. However, the person who is the owner of the company was with Midwest Asphalt. I've worked with them on a number of occasions. Left Midwest and started up the pavement division for park construction. Worked with that group last year in another city. Did a wonderful job on a mill and overlay project. And he purchased this company sometime between last fall and now. The company's been around for a while. I know they've done some work for, similar work for others that are in our consulting firm. And no one had anything bad to say about them. So they are a St. Paul-based firm. However, I do know the owner lives in the Excelsior area. So it's a little
financially solid.
They've been around a long time.
And do they have to put up a surety or a bond or something?
They do,
so that
yes.
If and then you monitor this very closely?
Yeah, I don't think that'll be an issue.
Okay.
They put up a performance bond and a payment bond. With the work I've seen with the current owner on other projects, I personally don't have a concern over it.
All right. Okay.
They've been around a long time, and this is kind of their niche. They're not a big outfit. You know, they do parking lot stuff like that, so driveways.
The other work that I've seen them with is parking lot. From others in my firm, they've mostly been familiar with it. It's been parking lots.
Well, we have another parking lot that we're thinking of doing next year. So, all right. Okay, then, are we mostly in agreement for the base bid plus the alternate bid A and C, with C coming from a different pot of money other than our park funds, but it seems to make sense to do that now at this time, so. Okay, is there and then the bid would be awarded to Buck Blacktop for this project. Is there a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second that.
All right, motion has been made and seconded to award the base bid of $323,875 along with the alternate A bid $57,386 along with the alternate C bid of $25,352 to the company of Buck Blacktop for the Lyle Park parking lot improvement project. Any further questions or discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, motion passes 5-0. All right, so that concludes our business items. We'll move on to administrative items, staff reports.
Yes, Mayor and Council, I have a number of items to touch on here. First off, our newest police officer, Justin Thompson, began with the city on August 2nd. You will see Justin, I believe I'm correct in saying, on September 6th.
Yes.
And he will be sworn in that night in front of you and then be introduced to the city council. Our other officer is just about done with his items. He's completed the physical. I think we're just waiting results from the psychological exam, and if things go well, which we hope, we should be able to set a start date that may not be exactly like 2 weeks after a notice he might give, because Chief Falls has to stagger the FTO field training for the two officers, and I believe Mr. Thompson started first because his field training is going to be less than the normal process because he's already been a licensed officer in the area, which is not the case with the officer, soon to be Officer Brown. We do have candidate filing closes tomorrow at 5 p.m., not 4:30. We will be open till 5:30. Some of us will be here till 5 p.m. Most everybody else will go home at 4:30, but Chris will be here and I'll be here. After that, and what we've done the last two election cycles is myself and the city clerk, previously with Terry, but now with Chris, we are holding a city council candidate informational meeting at 3:30 on Wednesday the 17th. Anybody that's filed receives that information when they pick up their packet. So anybody that has filed already knows about it. So so that'll be this Wednesday at 3:30. The reason for the timing of this, it seems kind of weird to do it right after the filing closes, but once filing closes, you have 48 hours to decide whether or not you actually want to do it. You can kind of get that two-day period to decide, maybe I do, maybe I don't. And so the idea is just to give prospective council members an idea of what it's like to be a council member. I don't think everybody exactly knows. And so my orientation and Chris's orientation kind of give that information to them. So there will be I'll let Council Member Christians talk about this, but there's the charity softball game on August 24th. What are we calling it? The
Guns and Hoses?
Guns versus Hoses. Cops versus Fire. The umpires for that game will be Jessica Loftus, who's the city administrator at Orno, Eric Hoverston, the Mount City manager, and myself. So that should be a fun evening. Hopefully get good weather. If council can remember back to February, we did include for the August 1st meeting, which we canceled, a potential EPA meeting. And because August 1st meeting was canceled, we have not rescheduled that. And I guess we could discuss that, but my recommendation as council is we really don't have anything for you to discuss in an EDA meeting, so I think we're actually probably better off just waiting until next February at the annual meeting to do the discussion. But in the meantime, maybe in the winter, we can kind of talk about some things related to it. We don't actually have to hold an EDA meeting now. So if I don't know if I kind of forgot about it, I was reminded about that we actually did have an EDA meeting scheduled for August. Tomorrow night at 6 o'clock in the police department will be the Halstead Drive Street Improvement Project or neighborhood meeting. I will be there along with Mr. Grimm and Mr. Hornby. And I don't know.
I'll be there.
From council, if you need to be there, I believe we noticed the meeting. So, you know, if you want to come, you certainly can. And anyone on the council. And just to touch on the election primary that took place a week ago, Tuesday, it was kind of pretty low turnout. We had 108 votes cast in the city of Minnetrista at all four of our precincts. So, and I think that was kind of the norm throughout the metro or the state. There was very low attendance for this particular primary. The only one we had was a statewide associate judge position. So, you know. And I believe that's all I have.
Okay. Any other staff reports?
I think we have Paul. And Nick. Go ahead, Paul. You're next.
I guess the main thing I want to talk about is the Enchanted Lane Improvement Project. From a staff standpoint, we have some discussion, especially through Public Works, about the condition of Tuxedo Road and Tuxedo Boulevard. And we had a discussion on whether that should be included in the Enchanted Lane Improvement Project. I don't know if you've driven out there. The main thing from a public work standpoint, I think there's two culverts that are failing or have failed, and then there's some shore area along the guardrail, along the lake on Tuxedo that did suffer some damage in 2014 when we had the high water levels in Lake Minnetonka. I just looked at some of the information we have in the pavement management plan. The segments on Tuxedo Road and Tuxedo Boulevard vary in their ratings from 19 to 55. The majority of it is 19. There's about 2,600 feet of it that's rated 19, which would be it's a failed road.
It's in
a reconstruct area. I don't know that we've done cores in that particular area, but I did take a look at what the cost was from a pavement management plan, and I believe the previous city engineer, Mark, had brought this up to the council previously. It was $1.3 million, roughly, to do that portion of the roadway. It's about 3,500 feet of roadway. I just looked at our prorated cost from what we're looking at on Enchanted Lane. If we did a reclamation project instead, which wouldn't address drainage issues, we would replace culverts with it, but wouldn't add curb and gutter, wouldn't add storm sewer, just reclaim the pavement, put a new mat on. that I'm just estimating around $530,000. Enchanted Lane, to give you an idea, is right around $350,000. Feasibility report. So if we wanted to, we could add this into the Enchanted Lane project and continue that project moving forward, or we could look at this being a project for another year. Right. We want to get the council consensus or council direction on how you'd like us to proceed.
So we knew we were going to move forward with the Enchanted Lane project, mm-hmm. but in order to do the, I think what Mark Erickson called it, was the border to border. You can go from Sherwood to Mound on this stretch of road. That would be all Minnetrista roadway. And so as long as we're over there doing the work on the Enchanted Lane process, that obviously could stand alone and go forward as is, but we thought we'd at least have Paul talk about that tonight. What we have not done yet, and what we still owe the council is and the residents is a meeting to kind of, like we're doing tomorrow night, for Halsted. You know, we still owe them a opportunity to come in and kind of give us their feedback, but we wanted to check with you at the council level to find out if you are indeed interested in maybe going, doing this project as a border to border, or just focusing on Halsted. So we're looking for your feedback. If indeed you want to include the Tuxedo Road portion of it, we can certainly do that. As Paul said, gave us some kind of thumbnail preliminary cost estimates on what it could possibly be. So just looking to get a little feedback before we start moving forward with the Halsted and or Tuxedo.
So did I hear you correctly? Enchanted Lane is $350,000 and Tuxedo is $500,000?
About $530,000 is a ballpark budgetary number.
So Tuxedo is going, that portion would be more than Enchanted Lane.
And it's also longer.
It's longer, right? Yeah. I mean, that's why.
Okay. It's about 1,000 feet longer.
Oh, okay.
If we want to, if the consensus or the discussion is that people think we want to do Tuxedo, then I think that when we get to the levy discussion, we need to think very seriously about that $100,000 or $75,000 towards roads. We've got to be realistic with what we want to get done, or what we're going to commit to getting done, and what money we have.
This would be rolled into the bond that we're thinking of floating.
This would be
the
bond.
This would be bonded.
Yeah. Which still is a consideration if you're adding. I know Halsted with being reconfigured and some of it, I think the project was over $4 million estimated, now it's 3.5, so maybe you'd have some wiggle room if you'd want to add back in Tuxedo. It's all going to be potentially, I mean, I think we've scheduled, you know, in our financial management plan to do around $4 million, give or take, of street. You know, it's going to be a big bond, or it's going to be a decent sized bond issue. So whether it makes sense to look at that now, or whether it's, I don't know, getting late in the process, or if it's going to muddy up Enchanted, I guess that's all things to consider, I guess. So,
say, Paul, if you're talking doing a complete reconstruction, what about utilities out there? What kind of shape are they in? How old are they?
Fortunately, the sanitary sewer is Met Council. I did talk to the Met Council. They don't have anything in their plans to do any rehabilitation work on that system in the foreseeable future. It's not in their CIP, so it's at least 5 years out. We don't have water main out there. Okay. The other utilities will have to contact private utilities, gas, communications, and so forth, but I think there's some overhead power and communications in that area.
How long has their sewer line been in there? And what I don't want to do is reconstruct this street, and then in 3, 4, 5 years they come along and say, guess what?
Right now, from what I can tell, it's not in their capital plan. So 5 years out, it's not in there.
Years isn't a very long time.
No, I understand that's not. That's going to be hard to predict as far as it's not on their radar right now. Mm-hmm. I can ask them if they had done a condition survey on it, but from the indications they have from the Met Council, they don't have any capital investment in that, improving that system.
Because a reclaim is going to get you roughly 20 years about.
Yeah, conservatively, I'd say it's a 15 to 20 year improvement project. You could get more out of it. Mm-hmm. And a mill and overlay for Tuxedo, I don't think would be appropriate, because there's so much of it that, you could put an overlay on top of it, and next year the cracks and the bumps and everything are going to be back. They'll just reflect back through the pavement.
But you're talking about a reclamation project, so.
I would, I guess I would recommend, from a council standpoint, to get 15 to 20 years out of that pavement, you could reclaim that at a reasonable cost and get a reasonable life out of it. Mm-hmm. And it's similar work to Enchanted, which is why you could include it in that project.
So what does happen if they come in and decide they want to replace their
at the very least, we'd have them restore the roadway to the condition it's in, the improved condition we put it in. Okay. I have had them do that in a couple of other projects in another community. And they have gladly come through and restore it for using the right of way. What they look at a participating cost from a city is if you're making an improvement. So for instance, there's one roadway we widened, improved at low point, increased the pavement section, and the city paid a portion of that amount in that particular case. So
they're willing to work with you. I mean, that would be the time to do the complete, is when they decide sooner or later they're going to have to replace that thing. It's been in there quite a while. Yeah. And then, we understand this is your cost. We participate, and obviously it's going to be a lot cheaper that way for the city, because they're going to subcut this thing. They have to.
So. Right. That'd certainly be a good way to do that. I think if Met Council had the opportunity, they probably would look at a non-excavation method of improving that line if they can. Slip lining or something
slip lining,
like that.
Yeah.
However,
that's true.
Yeah.
With the soils we have in that area, I don't know if that's possible. It looks like my recollection is that system went in the early 1970s.
Sounds about right.
So that's why we brought it forward and haven't gone forward with the scheduling of the
neighborhood meeting.
Neighborhood,
yeah.
Right. So we want to hear what you had to say. So.
Okay. So what are your thoughts? You want to move forward with Tuxedo? Do you want to wait?
If this is something council's also not doesn't want to make a decision on tonight, we can always bring it back in another meeting with more formal discussion on it. Rather than springing it on you.
I think that might be a good idea, because I think this is the first we've heard it. We need time to digest it. We need some more information. That would be a good idea. If it doesn't delay the Enchanted Lane project, if that's okay, when could you bring it back? September 6th or with more information? Or
Yes, I could bring this discussion back on September 6th.
Okay.
That's 3 weeks.
Yeah. All right.
Okay, and then hopefully we'll have a little bit
more. A little more information and also time to digest it a little bit. So, sounds good. All right. Anything else?
Nick Olson has something to share.
Mr. Olson.
Sure. Just to kind of give you guys a heads up, FEMA's working on updating their maps. That change will take place on November the 4th. In Minnetrista, that'll affect about 1,500 properties, 1,000 of which will see a change in floodplain, either an increase or decrease on their property, and about 500 that'll have the floodplain actually completely removed from their property. Like I said, this change has been brought on to us by FEMA updating their maps. The city is looking sometime, hopefully this week, to get some letters out to these residents, notifying of them of their options, of what they can do with this change, and if they're required to purchase flood insurance, ways to do it, and if they feel that they don't need to, ways to potentially prove that they're not within the floodplain. And we're aiming, we have sent some information over to the newspaper, hoping that either they'll at least write something either specific to Minnetrista or maybe something general, regarding lake communities, and that's some information they can use. Another way to get it out to residents, like I said, trying to inform them of their options and the opportunities that they have. Staff has worked with the Minnesota DNR on updating our ordinance to reflect these changes in the maps. Back on August the 4th, we received preliminary approval from them, basically consenting that the ordinance changes we have made are sufficient to meet the requirements. That item, I believe, the intent is to go to next Monday's Planning Commission meeting for the public hearing and discussion, and that's an item council may see on an agenda at some point in September. So just wanted to give you guys a heads up on that information. The second item I have is kind of a segue, is the Planning Commission meeting is next Monday. Being that we canceled the August 1st, it was, I believe, typically where the liaison will be determined. Staff is looking for any volunteers for next Monday's meeting for liaison to the Planning Commission.
Okay. I just did it in July. Who hasn't done it yet?
I did Parks last week.
Okay, Mark, have you done a Planning Commission meeting?
Have you done one?
Okay, and have you done one? So who's done two?
I think I've done two.
I've done two. Okay, Mark, Bob?
Next Monday I can't, again, a prior commitment.
Okay, Bob?
I can't really commit right now. I've got an awful crazy schedule on my luck right now.
Okay. All right.
What time is the meeting?
7 o'clock.
7 o'clock. So the steering committee meeting is prior to that.
Correct. Right. Yes.
Okay. There you go. Hate to schedule.
And we're going to be talking on that agenda. Will be this FEMA issue.
Yeah. On the Planning Commission.
With the Planning
Commission. Yes, that'll be one of the items on the agenda.
Okay. Then I will be at that meeting. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, what about a Park Commission meeting for September? Is there going to be one?
As of now, we have not received any applications that would require action from the Parks Commission.
Okay.
They did review their annual CIP at the last meeting, and as part of the comprehensive plan process, I believe in November, they have a scheduled meeting to discuss that as well. So as of now, nothing for September.
All right. And then September, we also have potentially have a Planning Commission meeting, and that would be September 25th or 20, what is that?
26th, I believe.
26th, okay. So maybe Mark, could you then take that, since most of us have done at least two?
I can try, but that's way too far out.
Okay, all right. All right, are we done with
that
staff?
That is all I had, yes.
All right, then we'll move on to council. I'll try and be brief here. So I did attend July 27th. Mr. Brony and I attended the Mound Fire Advisory meeting, and they shared a number of things with us. So one, there is going to be a free training opportunity for hands-on CPR and AED training. That's going to take place Thursday, August 25th, and it's from 7 to 8:30, and they're asking, the registration deadline is August 19th, so that's coming up very quickly here. Also, the guns and hoses, not roses, but hoses, they shared that with us. It's the Mount Fire Department versus the Orono and Minnetrista Police Department. It's an annual charity softball game that will benefit We Can, and it will take place August 24th at 6:30 p.m. at the WRA Fields at 7201 County Road 110 West in Minnetrista. The other thing is, basically at our Mound Fire Advisory Board meeting, we discussed budgets. The budget is, the levy increase will be an overall 2.79% increase. However, because of the way that they structure the formula, Minnetrista will see a 2.64% increase, which is a very nominal increase, but fabulous service, of course. Also then, I just want to mention that on October 13th, there will be a, in conjunction with Fire Safety Week, they will be hosting an open house, and they will also be maybe christening or celebrating the arrival of their brand new ladder truck. So that will be October 13th in the evening. Keep your calendars open for that as well. And also just kind of FYI, Minnetrista pays 24.51% of the Mound Fire Department's budget, and Mound pays 53.15%. I have a lot more information here, but I won't share that all with you this evening. Those were kind of the highlights, I think. Anything else regarding the fire board? No. I also was invited and did a Met Council wastewater treatment plant tour of the Blue Lake plant in Shakopee. very interesting, to say the least. And I also attended the National Night Out with Mr. Falls and also Dave Locke, who was the coordinator for that event, and want to thank him for his efforts on that. We were able to get to 6 or 7 parties that evening, I believe.
Yes,
so we had hoped to get to a few more, but we made it to at least those, and very well attended, and people were excited that we were there and so on. I also attended the MCWD neighborhood meeting on August 8th. You saw the presentation here this evening, so I was able to talk with some of the residents that attended, and we also had a personnel committee meeting on August 11th. Patricia, myself, and Mr. Brony and some others here attended that, and you got pretty much the updates on our personnel issues. And then I also attended the Gillespie board meeting on the 11th. Just kind of FYI, I've been back and forth with Mr. Brony regarding their newsletter and the fact that our name was omitted as a contributor to the center, and so I have spoken with them on that and be in touch with them again. We should be mentioned on a monthly basis or whenever they come out with their newsletter as their contributors, since we are one of the larger contributors. I did receive a thank you note. It just says, Mayor Lisa Whalen, City of Minnetrista, thank you for your contributions, city support of the Gillespie Center. We're so grateful for your generosity. Thank you. Thank you for your contributions. We are able to provide quality programs, great facility for the community to gather. Have a great rest of the summer. Mindy Anderson, director for the Gillespie Center. So with that, there will be no Pioneer Sierra Creek Watershed meeting this month. They did cancel that, so there will be one in September. I will be at the neighborhood meeting tomorrow evening. And also tomorrow morning, there will be a public safety meeting with Chief Falls and myself and Mr. And I'll try and attend the softball game. So that's it. I was at the Planning Commission meeting on August 22nd as well.
As has already been mentioned, I attended the Parks Committee Commission meeting, the Personnel Committee meeting, and then participated in National Night Out, riding with Officer Griggs. And we went to 3 parks. 2 were mildly attended, but quality nonetheless.
There you go.
And but also attended the gathering at Hunter's Crest in the park area. And I was amazed at how many people were there and how many children there were. There had to be 50 to 80 people there, and 3/4 of them had to be kids under the age of 6 or 8. So when we're looking at putting that park in or that playground equipment out there, I know at one point the thought was, well, have all of the residents who moved there and had young children at the time, are they all in junior or senior high now? There are plenty of young children that I would imagine will be using that playground equipment. So that was a good experience to see all those people come out that night. So,
okay, thank you. Mark, anything?
I have nothing.
I attended the We Can Coffee for Council this morning and met with Christy Larson, and she just wanted me to pass on the event coming up on October 1st, and if we could put this somewhere in the hall. She also gave me some more brochures to